Let us pray. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts, let them be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are strength, and Lord, you are redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's put our hands together and give God some praise today. He is so worthy to be praised. What a mighty God we serve. This is a great day to come and to worship God and to praise His name and to hear a word from the Lord. We thank God for all of these promise keepers who are here today, who are men of God, who understand it's not enough to claim the fatherhood of God and deny the brotherhood of man. If God is your father, then I'm your brother. God has children of all different colors, red, yellow, black, or white. We're all precious in His sight. We thank God for the vision of Coach McCartney and the leadership of Randy Phillips and all of the other staff of the Promise Keepers. And our prayers go up to God on their behalf that they'll continue to move in the direction that the Lord would have for them to go. I was asked to deal with the Word of God in this presentation and in this message. And there is a word from the Lord in the Gospel of Matthew. And I ask that you would turn to Matthew chapter 4. And even as we look at the Word of God today, we'll see that this is what Jesus used when He had to battle Satan and sin and temptation. And it's the same thing that we need to use in our battle against Satan, sin, and temptation. Matthew chapter 4, beginning with the first verse. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. In that first verse it says, Was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil? I want to talk just a few minutes about the devil's temptations. The devil's temptations. From his brimstone bed at the break of day, a walking the devil is going to look at his little snub form shape of the world and see how his stock goes on. How then was the devil dressed? Oh, he was in his Sunday best. His coat was red and his breeches were blue. And there was a hole where his tail came through. There's a lot of fiction in that poem, but there's some solemn reality that the devil does go to and fro, moving up and down in this world, looking for who he might devour. And I believe that the devil is after you and the devil is after me. One poet suggested that where God erects a house of prayer, Satan builds a chapel there. And 'twill be found on examination that the devil has the largest congregation. The devil is after you and he's after me. There is an evil presence. And I know that many of us are so educated and sophisticated that we don't believe in the devil anymore. We're too smart for that. Well, if you don't believe in the devil, then for the time being, go ahead and drop the D. You don't believe in the devil. You don't believe in the D-E-V-I-L. For right now, drop the D. You do believe in evil, don't you? And you know what evil is? Evil is live spelled backwards. And there is an evil presence that has so many of us living life backwards. There is an evil presence that has many of us thriving off of dirty deeds. That there is an evil presence that has racism running rampant and injustice running down like water. There is an evil presence that justifies the use of the word wrong and bad and wretched. But the Bible holds on to the D. The Bible says that this evil presence is not just some inner disorder in man. The Bible says it's someone working on man. There is an enemy. And this enemy is after you and he's after me. And as dangerous as the devil is and as powerful as he is, the devil only has 3 bullets in his gun. And he shoots those 3 bullets at us. The first bullet that Satan shoots at us is that the devil will try to keep you from being saved by grace. And if you don't remember anything else I say today, you remember in this devil's temptation that Satan, the enemy, will try to keep you from being saved by grace. And I know what somebody's thinking. Well, it's too late for me there, because I'm already ticketed for the kingdom. My name has already been written in the Lamb's book of life. My sins have already been washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm saved. Well, if he can't keep you from being saved by grace, then the second bullet that the devil shoots at you, he'll try to keep you from growing in grace. Try to keep you from growing in grace. He'll try to keep you from being that which God will have for you to be. Try to keep you from growing in grace. But somebody's saying, that's why I'm here today, that I might grow and develop as a child of God. That's why I support the work of God. That's why I study his word, that I might grow in God's grace. Well, if he can't keep you from being saved by grace, and he can't keep you from growing in grace, then he's going to try to get you to fall in disgrace. And Satan shoots that bullet at us from the cradle to the grave. He's trying to get us to fall in disgrace. And one of the ways he does it is that he uses temptations. Now, temptations in themselves are neither right nor wrong. When you deal with temptation, temptations are neither moral nor immoral. They don't work for you, and temptations do not work against you. It all depends upon how you respond to the temptation when it comes. If you respond by yielding and giving in to the temptation, then temptation becomes sin. But if you respond in faith with God, each victory will help you some other to win. It all depends upon how you respond to the temptation when it comes. And remember this, none of us are beyond temptation. You are not too young to be tempted. You are not so young that the enemy will not come at you and try to affect your walk with God. And you're not too old to be tempted. You don't outage temptation. You don't get so old that the enemy decides that now I'm just going to leave them alone. They're too old. You're not too old to be tempted. And you're not too holy to be tempted. Some of us walk around like we're so righteous, we're so holy. We walk so close to God that we never get tempted. Well, in our text, Satan tempts Jesus. And if he'll tempt Jesus, if he can tempt the Holy One of God, if he can tempt the one that's full of grace and truth, if he can tempt the one through whom all things were made and without him was not anything made that was made, if he can tempt the one that the fullness of the Godhead was in him, then surely we're not too holy to be tempted. The Bible says that temptations are common to all men. And even when you look in our text today in Matthew chapter 4, in that first verse, it says that Jesus was led by the Spirit. And then it says, into the wilderness, to be tempted of the devil. And that really bothered me. That really disturbed me, because verse 1 says that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. And then it said to be tempted of the devil. And I sat there and I began to think that, God, if you really want me to be a promise keeper, if you really want me to walk in your word, if you really want me to walk in your way, then lead me to where there is no temptation. But in this text, he leads Jesus even to a point that Satan comes and tempts him. And then the Holy Spirit let me know that even though the Spirit allowed the temptation, and Satan tempts us, they're after two different things. Satan tempts us and the Spirit allows the temptation, but they're not trying to accomplish the same goal. When the Spirit allows the temptation, he's trying to strengthen us. When Satan tempts us, he's trying to weaken us. When the Spirit allows the temptation, he's trying to get us to stand with purpose. When Satan tempts us, he's trying to get us to fall in perversion. When the Spirit allows the temptation, he's trying to mold and make us. When Satan tempts us, he's trying to destroy and break us. They're after two different things. That's why that songwriter said, yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin, but each victory will help you some other to win. If we respond properly when the temptations in our lives come, then each victory that we get will give us enough strength to handle the next temptation when it comes. But rest assured, the enemy knows when to tempt you. The enemy knows when to come after you. The enemy knows when you are most vulnerable to give in to temptation and sin. He'll come at you when you're at your lowest, when your bank account is the smallest, when your friends are the fewest, when your enemies are the meanest. He'll come at you when your day is the darkest and your outlook is the bleakest, when your mountains are the highest, when your valleys are the lowest, and when your rivers are the widest. The devil knows when to come at you and when to tempt you, when you and I are most vulnerable to give in to sin. Look at when he goes after Jesus. In the text, in verse 2, it says Jesus had fasted and prayed 40 days and 40 nights. Jesus was humanly hungry. I do understand that Jesus is the second person of the Trinity, that he is all God. But as he walked on this earth, he was also all man, all God and all man. And after 40 days of fasting, Jesus was humanly hungry. And that's when the devil came after him and tempted him in the area of economics. And when he tempts Jesus in the area of economics, the text says that he says to Jesus in verse 3, command these stones that they be made bread. Command these stones that they be made bread. Look at what he's trying to get Jesus to do. He's trying to get Jesus to do something wrong and then call it right because of his circumstance and situation. And that's just how he comes after us. He tries to get us to do stuff that we know is wrong. And then we try to justify it and rationalize it and try to make it right because of the situation and the circumstance that we find ourselves in. There is a school of thought that's called situational ethics. And in that school of thought, situational ethics suggests that something is right or wrong depending upon the situation that you find yourself in. But if you're not careful, that situational ethics stuff can mess you up. It can have you doing wrong things and you thinking it's right because of the situation you're in. I remember a couple was going to get married, and 2 months before they were to get married, they moved in together. And when I challenged them on that, they told me it just didn't make sense for her to pay rent in one place and for him to pay rent in another place, and they were going to be married anyway. They were throwing situational ethics stuff at me, that because of their situation, it called what they were doing right. Now look at what's going on. They are living in sin. My grandmama used to call it shacking. My mama's generation called it living together. My generation calls it cohabitation. The Bible calls it fornication, and all of it sin. And here they are. Here they are living in sin and trying to call it right because of their situation. But my brothers, I believe in the Bible. I believe that there are some things that are absolutely right, and there are other things that are absolutely wrong, regardless of your circumstance and your situation. We got to learn how to stand on the Word of God no matter where we find ourselves. Tempts them in the area of economics. And I know what somebody's thinking. You're wondering, what's wrong with turning stone into bread? If Jesus had turned stone into bread, there would be no more problems in Ethiopia. If he had turned stone into bread, there would be no more hunger problems in Indianapolis. If he had turned stone into bread, there would be no more hunger problems across this world. What's wrong with turning stone into bread? Well, one of the things that's wrong with it is it changes God's design. And if you want to know what the Word of God is all about, you want to know what Scripture is all about, it gives us God's design. And what Satan will try to do, what the enemy will try to do with you and me in our individual lives, in our marriages, in the way we relate to one another, in the way we raise our children, he'll try to get us to change what God has designed. Y'all do know that rocks are not designed for nutritional value. Nobody ever decides, I'm gonna fix something to eat and goes and get a rock sandwich. Nobody ever gets a skillet full of stones to prepare food, because that would change God's design. And we got to be careful as men of God that we stick with the Word of God and stick with the design of God. But he tries to get us to change God. And you know what? Even when Jesus performed his miracles, he never changed God's design. Even when he did his miracles, never once did he change God's design. It was either restoration, multiplication, or acceleration. He never changed God. You remember that man in the temple that had a withered hand? Y'all remember that? Some of y'all read the Bible? And Jesus healed his hand. Jesus didn't put a foot there. He just restored the hand back to the way it was. That's restoration. And remember when Jesus fed the multitude off 2 fish and 5 barley loaves? After Jesus got through blessing the bread and the fish, it did not turn into filet mignon. That would have changed God's design. He just multiplied it. That was multiplication. And even when Jesus turned the water into wine, it did not change God's design, because wine is 97.3% water. You deal with the grapes. And all he did was just accelerated the process. It was either restoration, multiplication, or acceleration. Never once did he change God's design. And if we're going to follow the example of Jesus Christ as men of God, we have got to make sure that we make up our minds we will not change what God has designed. That's not the only temptation. He comes back to Jesus, not only in the area of economics, but this time he tempts him in the area of sensationalism. He tempts Jesus a second time because Satan knows if he could get Jesus to give in to any one temptation, Jesus could not die for the sins of the world. He would have had to have died for his only sin, for his own sin. And so he comes back again and tries to get him. And this time he takes Jesus, verse 5 says, he takes him up to the highest point of a temple. And then in verse 6, he tells Jesus to cast thyself down. And let me just pause right here in this message. And notice what it says in verse 6. He tells Jesus, cast thyself down. That's because Satan doesn't have the power to make us fall. He only has the power to tempt us to fall. We are stuck with a dangerous and decisive freedom that Satan has the power to open the door to sin, but you and I must decide to walk in. The only way we fall is if we cast ourselves down. The only way we fall in disgrace is if we cast ourselves down. The only way we walk away from God is if we cast ourselves down. The only way we tear up our families is if we cast ourselves down. The only way we get strung out on drugs is if we cast ourselves down. The only way we get strung out on alcohol is if we cast ourselves down. And he tells him, if you cast yourself down, the angels will catch you. And when they catch you, people will see you land safely and will follow you because you are sensation. And you know what? Jesus could have jumped. And if Jesus had jumped, he would have landed safely. He is God. And he's God all by himself. He can do whatever he wants to do. Do it whenever he pleases. Do it right well with no input from you or me. He's God. He could have jumped and he would have landed safely. But I wonder why he didn't jump. I wonder why he didn't cast himself down. That's because Jesus knew that in 1994, the Promise Keepers would meet at the Hoosier Dome in Indianapolis, Indiana. And he wanted us to know that you don't have to jump just because you can. Oh, I wish y'all could see this today. He could have jumped, but he didn't, because you don't have to jump just because you can. Somebody listening to me right now, you could get caught up in some ungodly scheme right now. You can misuse somebody. You can mistreat somebody. You can walk all over somebody and get away with it. But Jesus is telling you, you don't have to jump just because you can. Somebody, you've been tempted to sell drugs because you can make more in a day selling drugs than you can on your job working all year. But Jesus is saying, you don't have to jump just because you can. Somebody's being tempted in the area of sexual immorality and fornication and adultery, and your wife may even put up with that kind of mess, but Jesus is saying, you don't have to jump just because you can. Somebody, you have what it takes to string women along and misuse women and get what you want from women, but Jesus is saying, you don't have to jump just because you can. Somebody, you haven't been dealing rightly with your children, with your sons and with your daughters, and you think you're getting away with something, but Jesus is saying, you don't have to jump just because you can. Trying to get Jesus to jump. Trying to get him caught up in sensationalism, telling Jesus that if you do it, the folk will see how great you are and you'll have an instant following, because they'll see you are sensational. And you know Satan is right. Sensationalism will draw a crowd. And I know sensationalism will draw a crowd because the circus comes to Indianapolis, and when it comes to Indianapolis, it'll pack out Market Square Arena that holds 17,000 people. It'll pack it out for 2 weeks straight because the circus is sensational. And sensationalism will bring a crowd. It'll bring out the curiosity seekers. And that's what some of our churches offer. The greatest show in town, the best gimmick going. Some of our churches are sensational churches, but you got to remember, it may draw a crowd, but that's only half the truth. Sensationalism cannot hold the crowd, because when the circus comes here for 2 weeks, packs out Market Square Arena, after 2 weeks it's got to go, because people get tired of seeing monkeys jump through hoops. People get tired of seeing dancing bears. People get tired of seeing gimmicks and games and sensationalism. It'll draw a crowd, but it will not hold a crowd. And I know we got some church leaders here today. And instead of going back with gimmicks and games on how to grow our churches, why don't we stick with the Word of God? Instead of jumping through hoops, why don't we stick with the Word of God? The Word of God can draw a crowd. And the Word of God can hold a crowd. And you know the Word of God has been proven by time. The Word of God has deathless durability. The Bible says that the grass withereth and the flower fadeth, but the Word of our God is going to stand forever. The Bible says heaven and earth will pass away before one jot or tittle of God's Word shall pass. Take a stand on the Word of God. And I'm not saying don't celebrate. And I'm not saying don't shout. And I'm not saying don't have a good time when it comes to dealing with Jesus Christ. But don't do it to be seen.
Don't do it to draw crowds. Don't do it because it's sensational. Do it because, like the old black preacher says, because you got the can't help it. And sometimes when the Holy Ghost gets a hold of you, you can't help it. Sometimes you got to shout. Sometimes you got to run. Sometimes you got to wave your hand. Sometimes you get a case of the can't help it. But it ought to stem from the Word of God. Jesus says that you shall not tempt the Lord thy God, and only him shall you serve. He sticks with the word. You want to know how to overcome your temptation? Because all of us are tempted in one way or another, sometimes economically, sometimes sensational. All of us are tempted. Look at how Jesus overcomes temptation. One of the ways he overcame temptation was through prayer. He had already prayed 40 days and 40 nights even before the temptation came. So when the temptation got there, he could handle the temptation. You want to know why so many of us give in to temptation so often? It's because we wait till the temptation comes before we start praying. When you're in the middle of your temptation, it's too late to pray. You got to be like my grandmother said. You got to be prayed up. You got to have a daily prayer. Every day you get up, you ought to be talking to Jesus. As you walk through the day, you ought to be talking to the Lord. Matter of fact, Paul said you ought to pray without ceasing. And when you are prayed up, when the enemy comes, you got something you can fight him with. And you know when we pray, our prayers touch three worlds at the same time. I know that I'm at my best when I pray. I believe in intercessory prayer. I believe in that. I got a church that prays for me, friends that pray for me, promise keepers that pray for me. I got a mother and a wife that pray for me. But I'm at my best when I pray. Because when I pray, my prayers touch three worlds at the same time. It goes up to God in worship. It goes out to man in work. And it goes down to Satan in warfare. We can deal with temptations if we learn how to pray. Not only pray, but if we want to handle temptations, the way to battle the temptations, the way to battle the things that will try to get us to change God's design, and to walk in a way that we know is not worthy of God, because some of us are sincere, but we don't have what it takes to battle Satan and sin. We don't have what it takes to battle the enemy and these temptations. Jesus fought him not with his own words. He fought him with the word of God. Satan came to him and tempted him. Jesus told him, it's written. Came back another time. Jesus said, it's written again. Came back a third time. Jesus said, it's written again. And when it was all over, it said that the devil left him. And he didn't leave him long. He left him for a season. But he was able to battle him with the word of God. If you want to handle temptation and sin, you take a stand on the word of God. Listen to what David said. David said, hide thy word in my heart that I might not sin against thee. David said, how can a young man cleanse his ways? By taking heed to the word of God. The way to battle Satan and sin is to spend some time in the word of God. And my brother, there is power in God's word. If you want to be the husband God wants you to be, check out God's word. If you want to have the right kind of relationship God wants you to have, check out God's word. If you want to be able to overcome the tempter, check out God's word. If you want to be a powerful witness for God, check out God's word. There is power in the word of God. Well, let me look at this last temptation and I'll go on and take my seat. Because not only did he tempt Jesus in the area of economics, and not only did he tempt him in the area of sensationalism, but finally, he tempted Jesus in the area of power. The text tells us that he took Jesus in verse 8 up into a high mountain. And when he took him up into this high mountain, he had Jesus to look at the east, the west, the north, the south. And he told Jesus, all these kingdoms of the world can be yours if you just bow down and worship me. Now remember earlier, he was trying to be sneaking and cunning and crafty. Tried to trick him into falling, but this time, he just comes to him straightforward. And sometimes the enemy is just like that. Sometimes he's just straightforward with what he wants to offer. Sometimes you can tell that the devil is after you. Sometimes he comes to you straightforward, and he tells Jesus, all the kingdoms of the world would be yours if you just bow down and worship me. And you know the problem with many of us is that some of us would do anything for power in this world. Some of us would do anything for prestige in this world. Some of us would do anything for prominence in this world. Some of us would do anything for possessions. We don't care who we tear down. We don't care who we lie on. We don't care who we lie with. We don't care who we lie against. We'll do anything to get kingdoms of this world. And you know what? Even as I looked in that passage of scripture, I discovered that Satan was promising Jesus something that already belonged to Jesus. Because the Bible did say that God has given him a name that's above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. That at the name of Jesus, every tongue should confess. He's promising Jesus something that already belongs to him. And some of us have been teaming with Satan to get something that God has already promised to you. And my brother, when God gives you something, can't nobody take it from you. If God opens the door for you, can't no man close it. If God has something for you, I don't care what somebody else get, can't nobody get what God has for you. And some of us are lying and cheating and stealing, trying to get something that God has already promised. And then many of us are getting things that are just for this world. But I need something that will go beyond this world. I need something that will travel with me beyond the grave. I need a power like Jesus Christ in my life that can handle this world and the world to come. Well, as I take my seat, I know the tempter is going to come after you, and he's going to come after me. He's going to try to tempt us to fall in disgrace. He's going to try to get us to embarrass promise keepers, to embarrass our families and ourselves, and to embarrass the Church of Jesus Christ. But my brothers, even as we gather in this place today, I want us to leave making up our minds like Jesus Christ, that we are not going to bow. When Jesus was dying on the cross, the devil came back to him and said, if you be the Christ, then save yourself. But Jesus went on and did what he had to do. He took a stand for God. And even as I leave here, I want to encourage you, don't bow to sin. Don't bow to lying. Don't bow to cheating. Don't bow to backbiting. Don't bow to wretchedness. Don't bow to wickedness. Don't bow to wrongness. But take a stand for God. Stand for Jesus. Stand for the Holy Ghost. Stand for what's right. Stand for what's good. Stand for God. Stand for your family. Stand for the things that God has promised and given unto you. And when you have done all to stand, just stand. And I know that the Lord, he will stand with you. Won't God stand with you? Won't God help you pay your bills? Won't God help you raise your children? We serve a mighty good God. Stand on the word of God.
The power of a promise is incredible. It is impossible for us to overestimate the impact a promise can make on us and on those to whom we make our promises. I came across a wonderful story that illustrates this. Mark Hansen tells this story. In 1989, an 8.2 earthquake almost flattened the country of Armenia, killing over 30,000 people in less than 4 minutes. In the midst of utter devastation and chaos, a father left his wife securely at home with their family and rushed to the school where his son was supposed to be, only to discover that the school was as flat as a pancake. After the traumatic initial shock, the father remembered the promise he had made his son. No matter what, I will always be there for you. Tears filled his eyes as he looked at the rubble in front of him. He kept remembering his commitment to his boy. I will always be there for you. As he stood there, he concentrated on where he had walked his son to class every morning. Remembering his son's classroom, that it would be in the back right corner of the building, he rushed there and started digging through the rubble. As he was digging, other parents arrived, clutching their hearts, crying, "My son, my daughter." Other well-meaning parents tried to pull the father away. "It's too late," they said. "They're all dead. You can't help. Go on home. Face reality. There's nothing you can do. You're just going to make things worse." The fire chief showed up, tried to pull the father off the school debris, saying, "Fires are breaking out everywhere. You're in danger. We'll take care of everything. Go on home." The police showed up. "We'll handle it," they said. "You're angry. You're distraught. Go on home." Nobody helped this dad. So courageously, he proceeded alone because he needed to know for himself if his boy was alive or dead. He dug with his hands for 8 hours, 12 hours, 24 hours, 36 hours, and in the 38th hour, he pulled back a boulder and he heard his son's voice. He screamed his son's name, "Armand! Armand!" And the boy answered back, "Dad, it's me, Dad. I told the other kids not to worry. I told them that if you were alive, you would save me. And when you saved me, you would save all of them. You promised. No matter what, I will always be there for you." The dad asked, "What's going on in there? How is it?" The boy said, "There are 14 of us left out of 33, Dad. We're scared, we're hungry, we're thirsty. We're thankful you're here. When the building collapsed, it made a wedge like a triangle, and it saved our lives. Come on out, son." "No, no, Dad. Let the other kids come out first, because I know you'll get me. No matter what, I know you'll keep your promise. I know you'll be there for me." The power of a promise is incredible. You and I will probably never have an experience anywhere near that dramatic, but we should never underestimate the impact a promise can have on those to whom we make it. Armand's father made a commitment to his son. I will always be there for you. And in the boy's worst moment of his life, he remembered the promise. I am here today to challenge all of us to think through and to make three significant promises before God regarding our family. As I think about the family in your life and in my life, these three relationships seem to me to be the most important, and I find them verified in Scripture. First, our relationship with our mother and dad, those who have gone before us. Second, our relationship with our wives, those who are going along with us. Third, of course, our relationship with our children, those who are coming along after us. Let's take them in that order. First, our relationship with our parents. According to the Bible, this is a relationship of honor and respect. Say those two words with me. Honor, respect. Do it again. Honor, respect. Listen to the word of God. Exodus 20. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be prolonged in the land which the Lord your God gives you. Leviticus 19. Every one of you shall reverence his mother and his father. Deuteronomy 5. Honor your father and your mother as the Lord your God has commanded you, that your days may be prolonged and that it may go well with you on the land which the Lord your God gives you. Ephesians chapter 6. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. Men, let me remind you that in each case, the verses contain not a suggestion, but a command. This is not a statement God makes to us for us to analyze, discuss, probe into, rationalize, ponder. A command is given for one reason: to obey. God commands that we obey His word. It has been my observation that this most basic of all earthly relationships is the one we tend to ignore and rationalize around. If God cares enough about it to include it in His list of commands, it dare not be trivialized. I challenge every man in this stadium to examine your heart regarding the relationship you have with your dad and with your mom. Before you leave, I plead with you to make a promise, to declare your commitment to honor your parents. They may have failed you. They may have disappointed you, neglected you, or caused something to happen in your life which has hurt you deeply. Again, the command stands. It calls for you and me to be big enough to forgive our parents of failures, to find a way to address God's command. Actually, you may have nothing against them. You simply may have never told them. Tonight, I would like you to break the silence barrier and find a way in the next few days to express verbally to your mom and dad, I honor you, I respect you. Dennis Rainey, in his book, The Tribute, calls this command the forgotten command. He says, instead of honoring our parents, we have taken the better part of the last three decades to bash, blame, and attack our parents for their faults and failures. Our parents have become a toxic waste site on which to dump the blame of our dysfunction. In the process of analyzing our backgrounds, which I believe is indeed an important part of growing up, Dennis Rainey writes, we have failed to take responsibility for our own attitudes and actions. We have failed to obey that which God clearly commands. Before you leave the Anaheim Stadium tonight, find a way in your heart to begin a process of forgiving, if that is necessary, of opening your mind and your lips to the thought that honoring and respecting your parents is the right thing to do. It is the place to start. There is a second relationship that has to do with our wives, those who are going along with us. According to the scriptures, this is to be a relationship of love and acceptance. Say the words with me. Love, acceptance. Let's do it again. Love, acceptance. Listen to the word of God. Genesis 2. Then the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper, suitable for him. So the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in that place. And the Lord God fashioned into a woman the rib which he had taken from the man. And he brought her to the man. For this cause, a man shall leave, listen to this, men, it's the principle of severance. A man shall leave his father and his mother, and he shall cleave. The Hebrew word means to bond, to glue, to be committed to for life. It's a principle of permanence. He shall leave his father and mother, he shall cleave to his wife, and the two of them shall become one flesh. The principle of unity, harmony, one flesh. And the two of them were naked and they were not ashamed. The principle of intimacy. And speaking of intimacy, Solomon writes, rejoice in the wife of your youth as a loving hind and a graceful doe. Let her breasts satisfy you at all times. Be exhilarated always with her love. For why should you, my son, be exhilarated with an adulteress and embrace the bosom of a foreigner? For the ways of a man are before the eyes of the Lord, and he watches all his paths. What grand reminders. Ephesians 5 states, husbands, love your wives even as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. It is from that verse, Ephesians 5:25, that I've come up with the words love and acceptance. When I think of love as Christ loved the church, I put those four letters together in a column, each representing an expression of love. When I love my wife, L, I listen to her. I listen to her opinion. I listen to her counsel. I listen to her words of warning. I pay attention out of love. I listen to her. O represents overlooking. I overlook her quirks, her idiosyncrasies, even her failures. V, I value. I value her as a person, as a friend, as a point of accountability. And the letter E represents expression. I express my love. The other side of this coin that makes it genuine is acceptance. Even as Christ loved the church, accepting us as we are. A big part of acceptance is unselfishness. Men, you know as well as I do that we are notorious in our selfishness. We take and take and take and take, and she gives and gives and gives. I suggest we turn it the other way around. We be the ones who give and give and give and give. Let me tell you a little bit about Cynthia and me. We went together for 1 week, and then I asked her to marry me. I don't suggest that, but that's what we did. We were together as an engaged couple for 18 months, during which time I was insanely jealous. I wanted her time, I wanted her attention, I wanted her affection. I wanted all she had directed to me. It almost broke up our relationship. I remember when I asked her if she'd marry me. Get this. She said, "Yes, I'll marry you. But I have a date tomorrow night, and I feel like I need to fulfill my promise to make..." To make matters worse, she was going to date a Texas Aggie. Right. She was going to go to a Texas A&M football game. This is back in the mid-50s. She was going to go with a cadet, and they've got this dumb tradition that every time the Aggies make a touchdown, the cadet kisses his date. But I was safe because in those days, Texas A&M rarely made a touchdown. The next day, I listened to the game on the radio, knowing the woman I was going to marry was in the arms of another man. Texas A&M won 48-0. I remember thinking, is there a God? I had to come to terms with my jealousy. You may have to do the same. You may have to come to terms with your brutality. You may have to come to terms with a lifestyle that turns your wife against you. You may have to come to terms with things that you have that are important to you, but they are hurting a relationship with your mate. I challenge you tonight to take a direct look at your relationship with your mate and ask yourself if it really is a relationship of love, where you listen, overlook, value, and express affectionately your love for her, where you accept her, which means you unselfishly live your life for her. There is a third relationship. It is a relationship we have with our children, and I'll call it the clincher. You think about your family, I'll think about mine. When I think about a relationship with my children, two words come to mind: nurturing and modeling. Say the words with me. Nurturing, modeling. Do it again. Nurturing, modeling. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. Interesting, Paul mentions first the negative, and he directs it not to mothers and fathers, but to fathers. Dads, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger. The New International Version renders that, do not embitter your children. The parallel passage handles it this way: do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. The plague of the father-child relationship, I have observed, is the creating of a broken spirit in the heart of a child who is demoralized and discouraged by a father who continues a stream of criticism, harsh, stinging rebukes, discipline that is administered too often, too strict, too severe. I've observed an absence of tenderness, of affirmation, of affection. I've seen many fathers having to keep too much control, making too many demands. That provokes your children to anger, men. The positive side says, rather than doing that, bring them up in the nurture. But before we get to that, bring them up is a word that means to nourish. To nourish. It's the picture of paying attention to, understanding, feeling the needs of our boy and our girl. It's the picture of a father who pays attention, who protects when protection is needed, who corrects when correction is necessary, who takes time and attention, who knows what's going on in and around the life of his son. I love the word picture Randy Carlson put in his book, Father Memories. Fathers leave a lasting impression on the lives of their children. Picture fathers all around the world carving their initials into their family trees, like a carving in the trunk of an oak. As time passes, the impressions fathers make on their children grow deeper and wider. Depending upon how the tree grows, those impressions can either be ones of harmony or ones of distortion. This is a wonderful time, as you sit in the stadium, to push the replay on your memory video. What scenes emerge in your mind? Emotional security, a moral, ethical value system, establishing necessary and healthy boundaries, taking time, cultivating a heart for spiritual things, and even the importance of having fun together. Gentlemen, when was the last time you led your family in a time of fun, laughter, enjoyment? Josiah Holland wrote these words: God, give us men. A time like this demands strong minds, great hearts, true faith, ready hands. Men whom the lust of office does not kill. Men whom the spoils of office cannot buy. Men who possess opinions and a will. Men who have honor. Men who will not lie. Men who can stand before a demagogue and damn his treacherous flatteries without winking. Tall men, sun-crowned, who live above the fog in public duty and in private thinking. While the rabble, with their thumb-worn creeds, their large professions, and their little deeds, mingle in selfish strife, lo, freedom weeps, and waiting justice sleeps. Josiah Holland wrote those words toward the end of the 19th century. Get this. During a period that has come to be known as the Reconstruction period in our nation, on the heels of a bloody civil war that took the lives of tens of thousands of our own men, Josiah Holland prays in his poem, God, give us men. As I read that poem as recently as this morning, I thought, really, God doesn't give us men, he gives us boys. He gives us girls. He gives us these impressionable, wonderful little people who bear our name. And we have the privilege of shaping, cultivating, and growing them into men and women of God. Men, I don't know what your relationship is with your children. They may now be in their 20s and 30s. You may now be a granddad. It's possible that some of you no longer speak to some of your adult children. For others of you, they could be in those impressionable preteen years or the teenage years. This is your moment to make a promise. Take a hard, straight look at your children. There was a song that Barry Manilow made popular a number of years ago. We walked to the sea, just my father and me, and the dog played around on the sand. Winter cold cut the air, hanging still everywhere, dressed in gray. Did he say, hold my hand? I said, love's easier when it's far away. He sat and watched a distant light. We're two ships that pass in the night. We both smile and we say it's all right. We're still here. It's just that we're out of sight, like those ships that pass in the night. I begin this talk with a statement, the power of a promise is incredible. It's time for the promise. This is called promise keepers, not just promise makers. This is promise keepers. So this is for keeps. Now's the time.
Now's the time.
I want you to bow your heads. I want you to close your eyes. I want to review briefly the three relationships. Honestly, before God, and only if you can do this truly in your hearts, I want you to make your promise verbally. Your relationship with your mother and dad, honor and respect. Your relationship with your wife, love and acceptance. Your relationship with your children, nurturing and modeling. If the Spirit of God is moving upon your heart, and one of these particular promises fits your need, I'm going to invite you to stand and repeat after me. Not now, but as we cover each of these three areas. First, if your need has to do with you and your parents, this one is for you. I'm going to ask you in a moment to repeat these words. Lord, I promise to find a way to show respect and honor to my parents. If you're willing to make that promise before God as a promise keeper, stand to your feet. Do not stand if you cannot stand in honesty. Please repeat after me. Lord, I promise to find a way to show honor and respect to my parents. Please remain standing. Perhaps it's your partner that speaks most loudly to you tonight. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand if it applies. Lord, I promise to cultivate a relationship with my wife based on love and acceptance. If that's the statement you're ready to say before God, stand to your feet. Please repeat after me. Lord, I promise to cultivate a relationship with my wife based on love and acceptance. Quite probably, this third one will touch us all. In a moment, you will say the words, Lord, I promise to begin a relationship with my son and daughter, for I will nurture and model strong Christian character. If that is your area of great need, please stand. Repeat, Lord, I promise to begin a relationship with my son and daughter, for I will nurture and model strong Christian character. This is a wonderful moment, our Father. You have heard these promises, these vows. You have told us better that you not vow than that you vow and not keep. Enable every man standing to his feet to find new ways of keeping his vow. Cause us to become not just those who attend a conference named promise keepers, but make us that deep within our lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. and everybody said, Amen. Turn around and welcome others to this vow that has been taken.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Everybody get ready for it. I don't want a half-hearted response. Here it comes. Good morning. I have had yet another birthday since we were together last time, and as I've shared with many of you guys, I have this neat thing that happens every year. All our congregation, a lot of other people, send me birthday cards, and everybody tries to outdo finding the funniest ones, because I pick the 15 funniest cards that are mailed to me out of the hundreds I receive from the congregation every year, and I read them on the Sunday morning after my birthday. And in fact, a lot of people have suggested I give up preaching and just go to reading cards. They enjoy it more. But I don't have time to read 15 this morning. I got to share two or three with you to get on track here. And a couple of the guys are still settling into the seats. You're making space for them. So let me do this. One of them, I actually told this before, but it's so good I've got to tell this one. This was not a new one. But this is on the front, there's a drawing of an exceedingly old person, a caricature of everything you could imagine that would look old. And on the top of it, it says, "This is Floyd. Floyd is very, very, very old. His mind wanders, he has no teeth, and he smells a little strange all the time." Then it says, finishing the front side of the card, "Do you know the difference between you and Floyd?" Inside of the card, it says, "About 3 years." Isn't it nice to be loved by people? I got another card, and on the front there's this little impish looking character. It says, "Hi there, I'm the birthday fairy. When I touch people with my magic wand, I make them look another year older." Inside of the card, little characters going like this, says, "Oh my heavens, I must have beaten the tar out of you." I get a lot of those kind of cards. I appreciate the one somebody sent me that says, "I felt encouraged," at least on the front of the card. It said, "I think birthday cards that make fun of someone's age are crude and insensitive." Inside of the card, "Don't you, prune face?" So much for comfort. Finish with a card that I got that in the front it shows this person striking a kind of man of destiny stance, and it says on the front, "Happy birthday to one of my most dignified friends." Then it begins a kind of soliloquy. It says, "You know, whenever I think of you, I always imagine you somehow standing on a high mountain, looking nobly into the future, the wind blowing your hair," inside of the card, "and you being too proud to run after it." I've been asked to talk with you this morning about the first promise of a promise keeper. And the first promise of a promise keeper is that he'll worship God. Wow, big theme. Big theme, big God, big subject. How do I get into it in a way that is real to my real world? Because not a whole lot to our daily life contributes to an atmosphere of worship. And worship so many times comes to a man's mind, indeed to the general society at large, as a kind of an escapist proposition, as though you're running from reality, when in fact, to come into the worship of God is to find how to bring what is our present reality into the presence of the ultimate reality, His person and His power. And I'm going to ask you to get your pencil handy and jot down two or three things this morning that I deeply believe the Lord is going to answer the prayer that I've made and many others with me, that He'll make this practical and functional for you, that in the personal experience of your worship walk with God, you find out this can work for me. I'm going to ask you to start with me by opening your Bible to the 12th chapter of the book of Genesis. Easy to find, first book in the Bible, and I want us to look at words concerning Abraham. Abraham, beginning in chapter 12 of Genesis, the first verse where we're introduced to him, he's called Abram at that time. His name later on is changed to Abraham. By the way, that's an interesting fact, that the adding of the ha, the breath syllable, Abraham, to Abraham's name, in a very real sense was in its very self, beside an addition to the meaning of his name, it symbolizes the breath of God's Spirit coming into a man, moving him into the place where what God has promised to him can become practical and realizable. And I doubt that there's a guy in this stadium today that wouldn't gladly say, I want God's promises in my life, but how do I move them from the available promise into the practical realization? And that's where personal worship comes into play. And I'd like for you to see that with me in the few minutes we've got this morning. And I want to tell you what our target is and where we're going 20 minutes from now, so that you begin to condition, prepare yourself for it. Because I've been asked not only to speak to you, but I've been asked to lead you into a time of both worship and of prayer together. Before the next 40 minutes have gone by, you and I will have been moving into not only the presence of God personally and availably toward Him, but into partnership with brothers around you, as we'll point the way to partnering in prayer with other guys. And we'll make that practical too. So that's where we're going. Read with me the opening verses. Follow me as I read Genesis 12, 1 through 3, and then I'm going to skip to a couple other verses in the passage. Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family and your father's house. That was, he was taking his immediate family away from his larger family, which would have involved hundreds. He, his wife and kids, nephew and some others headed out. Go to a land I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you and curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken to him. Verse 6. Abram passed through the land to the place of Shechem as far as the terebinth tree of Morah, and the Canaanites were then in the land. Say that phrase with me, would you? And the Canaanites were then in the land. I want to talk about that in just a second. Hold on to that phrase. And the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, to your descendants I'll give this land. Now listen, and there he, Abraham, built an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. The opening hours of this weekend of being together, we've been introduced to both the Master and our mission. Greg talked to us about our need of a Savior, a Master, one to bring us into life and relationship with God. And then we also heard the call to mission, that Jesus has told us He wants to do something through our lives, not only to our lives, but through our lives. So that we have both a master and a mandate, a savior and a call to service. For the exercise, the realization, the outworking of what Jesus Christ brings us to Himself to work through us, for the processing of that, we come to the realities of the day-by-day of our lives. It's a wonderful thing when you get together in a holy mob scene like this, where all of us are getting blessed up to our ears and rejoicing and the beat of our hearts is increased to a high pitch, and you know, it's pretty easy to serve God in this setting. But we part from here and go back to our own private situations on the day-to-day basis and processing the Master's call to us and the Master's mission through us becomes another thing. And the reason the first promise of a promise keeper is to worship God is not only that God calls us to move and worship life and relationship with a congregation in fellowship at a local church, but worship is not intended for an hour or an hour and a half on Sunday morning solely. That's something we do with others. The man's first promise is a personal worship of God, and that's something that calls us regularly into His presence and to understand how to do that. I've asked you to turn with me to Abraham because Abraham is a man who learned this. God called him out unto his purpose, and he said, and I'm going to make you a blessing. Wherever you go, I'm going to do stuff in your life that will be good for other people. And Abraham learned how to live that out by living a life that is marked by a pathway of altars he built. The study of the life of Abraham covers about 13 chapters in the Bible, and there are no less than 8 recorded altar experiences. Not in every one does it mention the word altar, but it clearly is an altar experience. I want you to look at 3 with me today. 3 altar experiences of Abraham. But before we do that, I want to talk about your building an altar, because Abraham did that. Abraham literally built altars as a pattern of pursuing the outworking of God's purpose in his life. Listen, brother, you and I process God's purpose in our life by learning a personal life of worship, which necessitates learning how to build altars. But altars aren't ecclesiastical furniture. It's not something that is tied down into a sanctuary you have to go to. You build altars by reason of a mindset, and that mindset is established when we take the way that Abraham would have built altars and see how practical that is in our life. What Abraham did in building altars basically was take rocks and stack them up in the presence of God, and then he would pour a sacrifice over it, and the sacrifice was the pouring out of his own heart, identifying his own need of God. See that picture of 3 things: taking rocks, arranging them before God, and pouring life out over the rocks. Now listen, seeing that picture of those kind of pouring life out over the rocks, it's a whole different scene from the on the rocks concept that people take today to deal with the difficulties of their life, where there comes the happy hour and give me one on the rocks, and it solves nothing but a means of escape. And we're talking about life being poured out over the rocks before God, where life finds an entry into an answer. Now, it begins by taking hard things, just as Abraham took rocks, and so did the ancient patriarchs. The men who God said, I can work my purpose in you, were no different than you and me. And God said, I can do it in you, but you need to learn how to take the hard things and arrange them before me. And every one of us have hard things in our life, tough stuff you deal with. And Abraham, let those rocks in your understanding symbolize hard things that are brought before God and arranged before him. And we don't pour a sacrifice out over it as he did. You pour out the sacrifice of your own heart in genuine openness before him, and accordingly say, Lord, I bring my tough stuff before you. I arrange it before you, and I look to you to resolve it. Look at the 3 kind of things that might be learned through Abraham's altar experiences, at least some of them. The first one we read was when the Lord said to him, I'm going to give you this land. Land in that time essentially pointed to a person's destiny. Property holdings were more than real estate. It had to do with what your life was about. It was his vocation. He would farm the land. It was his family. That's where they'd live on the land. And that's essentially what our life is, our vocation and our family, our walk with God before him. So that the promise of land was more than, here's a piece of real estate to speculate with. The call to Abraham saying, here's a land I have for you that is promised. Now please hear me. was infested with Canaanites. I asked you to repeat that with me a moment ago. And the Canaanites, essentially, were a satanic ritual culture. That isn't just inventing a phrase. It was a worship of demon powers. And to elaborate the Canaanite structures of religion and culture is to get into the worst expressions of humankind. It's the reason they were eventually destined for extermination. The Canaanites infested the land. What a picture. God says, this is the land I have for you, and there's Canaanites everywhere. And I tell you, brother, you and I live in exactly that kind of situation where God says, I want to give you a place where your life to be lived out, your vocation, your work to be pursued, your family to be raised, and everywhere you and I turn in the daily situations of seeking to raise our family or to go about our job, there's Canaanites everywhere, so to speak. And how can you see your life increase and realize God's purpose in that environment? And the answer is in Abraham's experience, that he took God's promise at his word, and though he saw the hard things that opposed, he built an altar. And the beginning place is when we come to learn that in building an altar before God in the face of the tough things, instead of trying to deal with them ourselves, we pour our heart out before him with the hard things there. What are the hard things? The hard things on the job. When you have to deal with the invitation to compromise your personal integrity on the job in order to retain it, to fudge on the truth or to outright lie. When you face situations where you're called to compromise character, how do I deal with the tough things when I live in a society that expects me to be something else and they approve it while God calls me to be something entirely different that the culture may not approve of? And in that environment, the only way you and I can handle that is to come and bring that tough thing, that hard thing before God, and on a regular basis say, Lord, I can't manage today or this week or the interview next Thursday or the job the confrontation I have to deal with on Monday. I can't deal with that without you, and I pour myself out before you, God Almighty. Only you can bring this about. Bringing the tough things before him, raising your kids. The tough things of the school situation where you are, or the friends your kids have started to take up with. How can I see the land, the purpose of God in my family and my job realized? Only by coming, taking the tough things before God. Learning to do that on a regular basis. Don't try and manage it yourself. Temptation. There's not a day that there's not temptation that faces us at the eye level if it doesn't at the heart and mind level. Bringing those hard things before God, pour them out before God. The first altar you build in personal worship is how to deal with the Canaanite stuff that tries to crowd in on your life when God wants to realize his purpose through you. Bring the tough things to him and lay them there before him. You won't get an instant solution that moment, but when it's arranged before God, instead of trying to manage it yourself, pick up those hard things, rocks, and carry them around on your back, and they'll wear you out and beat you down. Arrange them before God, and you're going to get an answer that comes from heaven. Hallelujah. The second altar Abraham built that we're looking at is in the 13th chapter. Don't ask me why. Abraham went down to Egypt. God had said, this is your land, and he went down to Egypt. And it takes too long to tell the story, but many of you know it anyway. Basically, what happens is he goes down there, and there are powers of government there who readily would take any good-looking woman that comes into their territory, kill her husband, and add her to the king's harem. Abraham, knowing this in advance, said to his wife, when we go there, say you're my sister, then they won't kill me. Sounds like as cowardly as a guy could get. But Abraham goes into this situation, and they take him at his word and say, well, she's your sister, we'll just add her to the king's harem, you can be alive. We won't kill you because you're not her husband. The story of how God intervenes and saves his wife from being exploited sexually by the king, and Abraham being embarrassed as a consummate failure, is another story that there's not time to get into. But the point is, Abraham had drifted off into a situation where he was compromising his role as the lover and the life protector of his wife. And after God gets him out of that situation, he comes back to the land God promised him, and it's there that he bows before the Lord and builds another altar. And it's an altar of return from compromise, an altar of return from where he had failed what he was supposed to be to his wife. My dear brother, my fellow companion in the man's kind of failure, of not being everything we ought to be to the primary, the only woman in our life. Listen to me, brother. One of the things that hinders more guys than we can imagine from coming with confidence into the future of saying, I know God, who is my Savior and Master, who has a mission and purpose for me. I know He can work through my life. What hinders that becoming practical when you get home and move from week to week and month to month and looking at year to year in the future? So oftentimes is either isolated incidents or a collection of episodes of having compromised what you were to be to that woman in your life. It may not have even been an instance of immorality, but just a compromise of accepting the responsibility and the care and the love and the attention and the time that she needs. Abraham's coming back into the land and building that altar, I think, symbolizes and represents a man's personal worship of regularly bringing before the Lord the fact that there is one real hard thing for me, and that's to be the kind of husband that I need to be, and to bring that before the Lord. And if it's been failed or compromised, to bring the brokenness and pain of the explosion of that failure before the Lord. There's stuff raining rocks around some of us that are here today. It's like the explosion of past failure. The rocks are coming around, falling down on you. You could be just knocked for a loop by your own failure in terms of your relationship with your wife. And the Lord says, bring those hard things before me, and I will bring you to a place of establishing so that that compromise won't occur anymore. Build an altar where there comes the securing of your responsibility and your fidelity. Building the altar that bears on your family, and the altar of returning from anything else that may have been compromised if it doesn't have to do with family. There's guys here that have known Christ and walked with Him for years, but your life is clouded by a point of condemnation that God doesn't want to enshroud your mind another minute, and certainly not to creep up from your backside day after day and say, you can't count for God today because of what happened a month, 6 months, or 6 years ago. I can't tell you the number of guys I've talked to, though they know Christ as Savior, and they say, I know I'm headed for an eternity with God. They live under a cloud of dismal condemnation constantly, and it cripples their confidence as a man of God. You take those things and put them before God and pour your own heart over what may have been the past and say, Lord, I make this hard thing laid before you, and I build an altar so that condemnation and failure and compromise will no more control my mind, and I can stand in confidence of your tomorrow for me. Praise the Lord. The third thing, dealing with the hard thing, had to do with the release of all future promise. It's a study in its own right. The 17th chapter of Genesis is the story of the Lord giving a covenant to Abraham. The covenant was a rite, a ritual. And that ritual comes down to this day in present-day Judaism. And because of the fact that the tradition of circumcision is so related to a religious tradition, many believing men who walk with Jesus Christ don't know that the Bible talks about a New Testament kind of circumcision that is called the circumcision of the heart. Years I wondered what that really meant, because the whole idea of circumcision, usually people wouldn't much talk about. It's a little awkward to talk about because of the physiology of circumcision. I'd never heard preachers much deal with it. And one day I got to thinking, I wonder what Abraham thought when God said to him, I have a token for you. Can you imagine Abraham saying, praise God, God's got a token for me. Hey, man, AB baby's got a token coming from God Almighty. And he says, what's my token, Lord? Lord says, Abraham, it's circumcision. Abraham says, well, what's circumcision? Well, it's kind of a private subject, so the Lord leaned over and whispered in Abraham's ear to explain circumcision. I want you to imagine Abraham's response as God whispered into his ear. That's my token. God says, that's it. Abraham says, thanks a lot. Who can I tell? And one day I got to thinking about the implications of circumcision. Listen to me, brother, I want you to write down three words. Why did God choose such an improbable sign as having flesh cut from the male member of the body? Here's why. Because he was calling a man to establish a kind of covenant, altar relationship with God. First, at the place on his body that most indicated his identity. The first thing that was ever said about any of us wasn't our name, but it's a boy. In circumcision, the Lord cuts to the core of our identity. And our identity is so superficially established in our culture. Our identity is in skills, in possessions, in achievement, in machismo. And God wants to pare away those things that are superficial suggestions of identity so we come to know Him on the basis of who we really are. He knows us, but in an altar time before God, you begin to find out really who you are. Cutting back away that superficiality that is not the real you. It cuts to the core of our creativity. For it is from the male member that begetting life flows. But that not only has to do with the creativity, the procreation of children, but the creativity of our own skills. God says, I want you not to be secured in what you can bring about, but to come before me to be reminded, I am the life giver and I will channel life through you, but only if you let me do surgery on you that cuts away the stuff you'll add to it that doesn't make it mine. And circumcision also cuts to the core of our privacy. That there be no secrets before the Lord. If there is any single thing, dear brother, that has become the key, my walking with Christ for almost a half century, since I was a 10-year-old boy, I believe that the key is coming to know what it means to keep your heart transparent and totally vulnerable, open, correctable, teachable before God. To let God do surgery on your heart on a regular basis. You come to the altar of a daily walk with Him and say, Lord, work here. Work here. Cut away the superficial. I hold no secrets. God knows all that we do, but that He knows all is not really material until I come and bear all before Him. I told you when I began that I had the privilege this morning of leading you into a time of worship and prayer. The instrumentalists and singers are coming to join me right now to assist that. As they do, I'd like to ask you, dear brother, do something with me. Would you lay aside everything you have in your hands so that you can just lay your hands there in your lap open, just there on your legs, lay your arms, turning your hands upward. In a posture of openness before God. I emphasize that openness. Please hear me. One of the frequently distressing things to me is the fact that the simplest physical expressions of worship to God have somehow been sectarianized. Turned into something that only some people do rather than all the Lord's people. This matter of opening my hands before God never was intended to be some ritual expression, but a physical declaration, a kind of a personal prophetic statement to God. God, I'm not defending myself, I'm open to you. The lifting of my hands before God was never intended to be some ritual, perfunctory exercise of a sector of the Christian church, but as the Apostle Paul said, I would all men everywhere lift up holy hands. Why? Just to go through a calisthenic? No, to say, God, on this fresh new day, I bring what I'm to be before you, but I'm not only opening myself before you, but surrendering myself to you, O God. And as I come in my personal worship before God, I literally and physically express what my heart is saying. God, pour your holy fire on me and purify me that I may be empowered. Hear me, brother. My good friend Chuck's coming in a few minutes to talk to you about the power of God in your life. But he wants to come and move daily in a vessel that has let him purify him. I'm going to ask us just to listen as the singers sing through one time, then you join them the second time. But close your eyes. At some point while they're singing, purify me, Lord, I'm going to ask you to move from openness before the Lord to surrender on your own initiative. I'm not going to tell you when. You go or you just say, Lord, here I am. And we'll sing together after it's been sung through once. Purify my heart, O Lord. Let's close our eyes. Lift your head, though. Eyes closed, heads upraised, hands open. When you're ready, lift them in surrender when we sing. Together, shall we, brothers, if you haven't stood? I love you, Lord. I lift my heart,
Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice. Joy, my King, in what you give.
God, we come before you this morning, our hearts upraised before you with our hands, saying, oh God, only you can enable us to see processed in and through us the things you have ordained for us. We would learn the pathway of bringing the hard things before you in person and private in your presence. But Lord, we would also want to learn the power of openly speaking our hearts to brothers who would pray with us. The power of agreement in prayer. The power of bearing one another's burdens and fulfilling the law of Christ. In this moment, I pray, Holy Spirit of God, that you would breathe now upon each one of our hearts with a fresh honesty toward God, establishing something of your ways in us. Would you quietly lower your hands? I'm not going to say amen to that prayer because it's not over. I want it to continue. Look this way, please. I'm going to ask you to do something. Through the course of this day, there will be other times we'll do it as well. But this first time, it's a thing so unlike a man, so unlike a man, that everything in us will tend to protect ourselves from what I'm about to suggest. But we need each other, and we need to speak our hearts to each other. I'm going to ask every man, I'm going to ask groups of four like this. Two guys in your row, you and a guy next to you, turn in a minute to a guy either in front of or in back of you so that it makes four in a circle. Wait a minute. We're going to have 13,000 circles in this room in just a minute. 13,000 groups of four guys that are going to, in the next 3 or 4 minutes, each guy says, pray for me about this. Like, I'm going through one hell of a temptation because of a woman in the office where I work, and I wrestle with the challenges to my mind and the temptations there. Another guy will say, I have miserably failed in ways too embarrassing to describe, but will you pray for me that I might be released into my future? Another guy may say, I am scared spitless about my future where I work, and that fear dominates me more than faith does. Will you pray for me as I face the challenge of my future? Another guy may say, my kids are messed up and probably because of me. Would you pray for my kids with me today? But just two sentences bring hard things together. Speak them openly and honestly. We don't need to impress each other. We're just plain dudes trying to serve the living God, and we need each other as surely as we need the Lord. Turn, share your request, then pray for each other. Do it now. The next 3 minutes are yours. Go on. Turn to the guys in back of you, in front of you. Let's do it. We'll come back together in a minute singing, but do that right now. Speak your heart openly, forthrightly. Let's pray with and for one another. Thank you. circles begin to conclude and turn back this way, we're going to worship some more.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
God!